first, I would like to thank Lisa for the invitation to come here to talk with all of you. I believe that the most of the answers for my patients is not from the seeing the patient as an individual. The answers will come from people who works in public health. So you may find the answer for some of the problems that I have with my patients. What we're gonna do today first is talk a little bit about Panama, so you can know what is the profile of the country. Then talk to you a little bit about how is the HIV epidemic in Latin America and especially in Panama. Then talk a little bit about how is testing, care, and treatment of HIV specifically in Panama and from the perspective of the public health hospital where I work. And finally, some ideas for research and the challenges that we have as a community in Panama. So first, Panama is a part of Latin America. As you can see here, is in the middle of the Americas. You know, most of the people know Panama because of the Panama Canal. We speak Spanish there. That's why you can listen to the funny accent I have. And the currency we use is called Balboa, but at the end we use US dollars in Panama. And this is something I don't like that much. It sounds that I earn a lot of money, but it's not true. Panama is supposed to be a high-income country, but behind that, we have a population of about 4 million people. We have a pretty high life expectancy of 75 years old. But the problem here, or the reason why I am here with you speaking about HIV in a high-income country, is that according to Gini income inequality score, we are like the third more inequality country in Latin America. And as a matter of fact, Latin America is one of the most inequality regions in the world. So even if we appear as high income, everybody doesn't have access to good health care. And you know what is the problem of being high income, right? You can imagine. We don't really have access to all of the help that we can, economical help that we can get from agencies or NGOs. So that is a problem. And this is inequality. Basically in Panama, the ones here that had the opportunity to go to Panama can see these beautiful buildings and you get impressed of, oh, Panama is growing. There is a lot of money there. But at the same time, you can see there is poverty around and there is a lot of inequality. And a picture of this is when we review the causes of mortality in Panama, usually in most of the country, the first infectious disease cause for mortality is pneumonia. But for me, it was surprising to see that for 2015, in Panama, HIV was actually the first infectious disease cause for mortality in my country. So this is something that we need to look up. And let's talk a little bit about our healthcare system. In Panama, you can get healthcare system from three ways. You can go to the Social Security if you work, you pay for it, that's the biggest system you have there. If you don't have any Social Security, you can get access for healthcare with the Ministry of Health, and that is the hospital where I work, one of the hospitals on the network. Or if you have money or you pay for private insurance, you can go for private practice, but that's small amount of people, right? What about epidemiology of HIV in Latin America and Panama? Even if you compare Latin America with Africa, that is usually what gets most of the resources for research and assistance, in Panama, in Latin America, the numbers are not that high, but still we have 1.8 million people living with HIV, with a prevalence of 0.5%. Please remember the 0.5%, because this is why I think you invite someone from Panama. Because if you compare Panama with the other countries in Latin America, we have the second place in Central America of highest prevalence of HIV with 0.9% in the population of between 15 and 49 years old. So definitely something is happening in Panama, and we need to find answers from the public health perspective. This is from there's a Latin America workshop. We are some physicians that work with HIV that we meet and we share our data. And At the end, they unify at least 30 different hospitals in 8 countries in Latin America. And the idea with this graphic that you see here, the message is in Latin America, we are doing HIV diagnosis too late. At least 60% of the diagnoses are being done with a CD4 of less than 350. And you can even say 80% are late if you said that for you late if to come to the clinic with less than 500 CD4. But what is even more dangerous is that at least 40% are coming already with AIDS. It means with already an opportunistic infection or with a CD4 count of less than 200. So the message is we are losing 5, 6, 10, 8 years that we can do a test and get people into treatment without having diseases. Here are the total numbers of Panama for 2018. Basically, right now we have about 18,000 or 19,000 people living with HIV in the country. It is it's more in male than female, with a 70% in male and 30% in female. And something that I talked to you when you came to Panama that really caused is different if you see the province in Panama. In Panama, we have 10 different provinces. And we also have these indigenous areas called comarcas. So for provinces, that's something that calls my attention is that this one that you can see here in red, that is in the Atlantic, the behavior of HIV is different. There it may be 50-50% between male and female. And I think there is opportunity for research there to see what are the dynamics in that province that is only an hour from our capital or Panama City. And this is Colón, the province that I'm talking to you. There is a lot of poverty and high crime rate. And those are some of the barriers that we may face trying to figure out what's really going on there. Maybe more sex work. I honestly don't have the reasons. And in Panama, the HIV epidemic is concentrated. So basically, you can find most of the patients in Panama, in the province of Panama, especially in the city of Panama, Panama West, San Miguelito, Colón, the province I just mentioned. And the other province that is also in red here is called Chiriquí. This one is next to Costa Rica. And the problem with Chiriquí is that the large numbers that we can see here are, the drive there is the indigenous community that has also a high prevalence of HIV, and we can talk a little bit more about that in the next slides. UNAIDS, they do some kind of estimates of new cases. And when I review this in their webpage, basically they say there that we have a change in new HIV infections and that we are decreasing the number of new HIV infections. We think this is not, this estimates, there's something wrong there because this is not what's going on. As you can see here, these are the HIV new cases in Panama, and you can see how it's increasing. And in this year, we are closing with 1,500, above 1,500 cases. So actually, this is not going down as the numbers that we just reviewed last week with the Ministry of Health. And you can see that still in Panama is the province where we can see most of the patients that are new with an HIV diagnosis. And the other problem here is that most of these new HIV diagnoses is pretty young people. As you can see, 60% of the new diagnosis, this is specifically from my clinic. In Santo Tomás, we take care of about a third of these new HIV diagnoses. And this is our data from 215 patients of last year. And as you can see here, 60% of the patients are less than 40, so from 30 years old. So it's pretty young people. And even a 10 or 11% are adolescents or even more youngest people. So we have a big problem there, and we need to talk more about in the next slides. It's also concentrated, the epidemic, in some key populations. Definitely, the prevalence of HIV is above this 0.9%. If we look at MSM specifically, there is about 20% prevalence when some studies have been done there. And it's even more worrisome in the transgender population, where you can see that about 30% of prevalence of HIV that we can find in that population. And the study of this population is very important because we need to find what is the bridge between these high prevalence populations and the other lower prevalence populations that are the drivers for this increase in new cases of HIV. This is our HIV treatment cascade. I think you are all familiar with the goal of the 90-90-90 for next year in a few days. Definitely, definitely Panama is not going to reach this objective. As you can see here, in the first 90, we only have 77% of the people diagnosed, and I think this is even maybe worse because we are using low estimates of HIV people in Panama. Then, of these patients, only 78% are on treatment, so we are again far from the 90% that we are looking for, and only 43% are undetectable. Here, we also need to talk about another barrier. There is not always access for viral load, so it may be only between 40 or 60% coverage of the patients with viral loads. So this may be higher, but if you don't have it on paper or a number, you cannot say this is high or not. So this is what we have, and we are not getting close to the 90-90 for next year, definitely. The other problem is we still have vertical transmission of HIV. You know how sad is when a child is born with HIV. It's very difficult for his or her entire life. And we are still between 3 and 5%. And you know that the goal is to have less than 2% of vertical transmission of HIV. And we know that the problem here is prenatal care of the pregnant woman, because some of them just don't do the test. In Panama, you're supposed to do the test during the first and the third trimester. But definitely some are not doing this care. And now we're going to talk about the comarca or the indigenous communities. As you can see in this map, these yellow lines with white, I'm going to talk about the two most important comarcas, that is the Nove Bugle and Cunayala. Actually, in numbers related to HIV, Nove Bugle apparently has a bigger problem. But we need to keep an eye on Cunayala. Both have different barriers or difficulties for addressing this epidemic. If we talk about Cunayala, I'm going to show you a picture in the future, so you can imagine will be the problem there. And Nove Bugle, we can see that the problem there is that it's mountainous region, very difficult to access in a geographical way to see it. And we have at least 12% of our population belongs to an indigenous community, and 93% of these persons are considered multidimensional poor. So basically, it's very difficult. They don't have good access for healthcare. And of these about 200,000 people, at least 10% are pretty young, between 15 and 19 years old. And this is a picture of people from the Nove Bugle community. And with this, you can imagine how difficult it is to actually have good healthcare system access when you live so spread in the mountain without access. And in the statistics of Panama, 2.4% of the HIV cases are in community. And the most affected group is between 20 and 29 years old. And this is an example of the community. And the Nole Duima, even for me it's difficult to know the names in their language, is the district with the highest HIV incidence. There are some people that have been trying to see through mortality, because mortality is an indicator that is difficult to hide, right? So everybody keeps good count of the dead. So here we can see in general, for HIV/AIDS, the mortality rates, as we suppose, is going down because we have treatment, we have access, we treat everybody with no cost. But for some reason, there is a signal there in the Nove Bugele community that the incidence of HIV is actually going up in pretty high numbers. And also, the mortality related to HIV is not going down as is going in the rest of the country. So something is happening there. I should have put a picture there of Amanda Gabster, but she's somebody very committed to study STIs in these communities, indigenous communities. This is not difficult to do. I really admire her with going there, eating with them the food. She really belongs to the community. And she did this study in the Comarca Nove Bugle, and she just recently published it. And in at least about 500 school-going participants between 14 and 19 years old, as you can see here, she found 1% prevalence of HIV for male and for female 0.4% in that community. So definitely, these are people that are starting pretty early their sex relationship, and also they are not using condoms. And we can go and check chlamydia and syphilis, and also the numbers are pretty high. So something is happening. Even she told me that there are problems there, that when they have been doing these studies, they have found problems because these people, there may be some abuse, and then you have to go with the authorities. So it's very challenging to do research specifically in this age group of people. And this looks very nice, and this will be the picture for the other comarca, the Cunayala one. So basically, it's more than 300 islands in a very nice paradise, but our island that is very spread, so it's very difficult to go to each of these islands to actually have very good numbers. So this would be the other comarca, just in case some one of you are interested in doing research there, I think it would be very nice. The other thing we need to talk about, if we are talking about HIV, is that basically Latin America is losing its battle against teen pregnancy. And definitely this teen pregnancy and HIV and early start of sex relationships is all part of the same problem. And for me, specifically for this lecture, I look for the adolescent fertility rate, and I haven't realized before that basically Panama has a very high fertility rate, and it's a problem of America, of Central America, but Panama is above the average of Central America. And I was looking at US, for example, they put North America is 28, this adolescent fertility rate. So we have almost twice or thrice the number of that you have here. So definitely we need sex education, if you believe it or not. And the problem, as you can imagine, is even bigger in the Comarca Nove Bugle, with most of the early pregnancy that you can see in the country are related to this region. And this is how my society plans to answer to this. People is asking for a sex education law that is called 61 law, and this is what we find, no? Don't mess with my children, no to law 61. We have basically most Catholic religion, and basically there is a lot of opposition from the community, and we haven't been able to pass a law. But definitely I think I have shown you that we really need to pass that law. And this is not specifically in the Comarca. This is in Panama City, also a study done by Amanda Gabster. For 2015, she also found in schools in Panama City that the prevalence for HIV, look at this, in male was 2.2% and in female 5.8%. But what really caused my attention in this study was the positivity to chlamydia in females of 30%. And every time I mention this, I go ahead and look at the number again, and I can't believe it, because we don't do any screening for STIs in nobody. HIV or no HIV, we don't do STI screening, because we basically, we treat them by syndromic. Basically, you have to have symptoms depending on the syndrome, we will treat you as an STI. If you don't have symptoms, that is supposed to happen in most of the women, you will realize you had an STI when you plan to have kids, I don't know, hopefully 30 years old or something like that, and then you will know there is infertility, and it may have been because of chlamydia acquired earlier and haven't been realized. So there is also another important need in Panama healthcare for testing for STIs. So talking about HIV testing, we have been looking for new strategies. Well, I say me, but actually the Minister of Health is looking for new strategies to increase testing. And as you know, we have these key populations, right? MSM, transgender people. And basically there's a lot of stigma and discrimination. And one of the strategies that have been proposed is to have these special clinics or friendly clinics. In Spanish it's called CLAMS or Clínicas Amigables, friendly clinics. Basically with different times of operation, with a healthcare personnel more open to treat this population. And we have six of these clinics in Panama. The problem here is the economic support for this clinic mostly come from agencies outside of Panama. So we really need the Ministry of Health to actually embrace this idea and also pay for it by itself. Another thing is this access to point of care testing and rapid tests. I spent here a few years ago in the 1970 clinic. And I noticed how is testing done by the communities, outside the hospital, by people that is not necessarily a lab technician. And in this way, you find more people. In Panama, there's a law that if you are not a lab technician, I cannot run a rapid test for HIV. It needs to be a lab technician. But I have to say that last year, the Minister of Health had a small win because now some people can do it, but only in these areas that I just showed you that are difficult to access geographically, then people that is not lab technician can do the test. But in Panama City, actually, it cannot be done if somebody is not a lab technician. There is also this need for informed consent to do the test. And there is people that favors it, there is people against it. And well, I think that's most a barrier than a protection for confidentiality of the patient. But we can talk about it for hours, actually, with patients. Adolescent testing, that's another question. Unless you are above 16 years old, you can do the test by yourself. If you are less than 16 years old, you cannot do the test without your parent permission. So there is another, and we have seen the numbers in people with 15 years old, 14 years old of HIV. So there is a need also to address this problem. And I always ask this about self-testing that also can be done. But in Panama, we are pretty far away from this. I know this is not for everybody, but I'm pretty sure there are some populations that will benefit from self-testing. Care, in Panama we have 17 clinics that treat the patient for free. And we basically test and treat. We don't wait any CD4 for start treatment. And the picture you have there are the two main clinics of Panama. This is my hospital, Hospital Santo Tomas, a public reference hospital. And this is the other bigger one, that is the one of the Social Security. Between these two hospitals, we have more than 10,000 patients in Panama, almost half of the patients with HIV in Panama. So now let's talk about Hospital Santo Tomas. We are a 600-bed hospital. And I put this picture in this way to remember that when I take care of a patient, they have two ways. They can go to the clinic with my friendly personnel there and start and attention their care there, or unfortunately go to the hospital. And every time I have to hospitalize a patient with AIDS, for me this is failure of the system, of everybody. Something that really called your attention was the fact that even if we have 40, initially 20 beds for HIV AIDS care, we have been increasing the numbers during the years to 40 beds, And we always have between 20 and 30 patients waiting in the emergency room to get a bed. So this is not going down. And what are the numbers of the patients that come from the first time to our clinic to look for attention? As you can see here, it has been between 700 to 900. But these 500 is those are that are naive, that haven't received HIV treatment before. And one of the challenges that we have in this population is that at least 30% in the last few years, and we have been increasing patients from foreigners, right? Especially from Venezuela. So this is another important fact to have into consideration in the drivers of the HIV epidemic in Panama. And I think this should be also more research into this population. And this is a good article that points this problem specifically. Based on this and in initial of care, since February 2018, we start rapid treatment. Or basically, the patient comes with a test or with a reference, and we decide to start treatment the first that day or maximum 7 days after the patient comes to the clinic. And with this, we have been better retention in care, and we have been better treatment for patients and more patients with undetectable viral load. But we still have challenges because, as you can see here, the numbers goes down. We start with 200, and maybe at the end, only a few has the viral load for the year. And right now, we don't have reagents to do the viral load, for example, or CD4. So right now, we are starting patients without knowing what is the CD4 value. And I really think we need to know the CD4 when we start treatment because that tells us if we still are diagnosing people late. So we are supposed to be a high-income country where we have our limitations. And we have trying to go to the news and try to educate people about the clinic, about our initiative. And the last 2 weeks, we have been visited by different newspapers and TV to talk about the clinic. And this is what we have in the hospital. This is failure, right? These are people with AIDS that get easy into the hospital with an opportunistic infection, and about a third or a quarter of them at the end die. So hopefully we should see these numbers goes down in the future, but I don't see it in the near future. And this is the face of AIDS, HIV in Panama still. We have a lot of tuberculosis, histoplasmosis, toxoplasmosis, cryptococcus meningitis, sarcoma, Kaposi sarcoma. And this is still the face of AIDS in Panama. And this is really bad. Histo was discovered, was first reported in Panama during the Panama Canal building. And we face this disease still every day in our practice. As you can see here, at least 30% of our patients that are tested when they come to the hospital are positive for histo. We know that in Panama in Latin America, it's very difficult to differentiate between histo and tuberculosis, and there is another space for research in the future related to treatment. Our first line therapy is called tenofovir endocitabina efavirenz, and the problem here with efavirenz is that we already know that at least 12% of our patients may have primary resistance to this drug. So there is another challenge here. In paper, we're supposed to migrate to use integrase inhibitors, but right now this is what we are using with the patients, and the challenge of the viral load coverage of patients, and we have a lot of loss to follow up. At least we find that 24 of our patients abandon therapy at some point, so we need to find the reason, especially you from public health, the public health school, I think very good qualitative studies are very needed to know why people are diagnosed so late and why they abandon therapy. Well, what are the challenges? Don't concentrate in this table that is in Spanish. I did it on purpose because basically when we ask for numbers from the Ministry of Health, it's very difficult to see the epidemic as you should. You see, if you ask for risk factors, for example, they put like bisexual, heterosexual, homosexual, transsexual. So it's very confusing for people. What we really know, for example, we need to know is the number of MSM or the percentage of MSM, for example. And at the moment, the reports of Panama, I think, are a little bit behind of what we actually need to know the epidemic. And this is another area. I just put this, talking about PrEP. I think you are all familiarized with PrEP or prophylaxis, pre-exposure prophylaxis. And basically, as you can see, Latin America, except for Brazil, there's no data, and basically it's not available. Governments are not talking about that, especially because I think society is also here. You're pretty sure they will say no, because I'm going to give you a pill to give you permission to have sex. So if we don't have a sex law education, I think we are also behind for PrEP, and we know that this is a strategy that can decrease 92% the transmission of HIV if you actually take the pill every day. So as a summary, I think adolescents are an important population in Panama. Antenatal care is something, or prenatal care is something we need to take care. Indigenous population, even if I've shown you that it's geographically difficult to access, is also a population that we need to take care of. They are at least 10% of Panamanians. Retention and care is another problem. So definitely a stigma and discrimination needs to be worked a lot more in the community. We need to have continuous availability of the drug, and we need to have better drugs. We know efavirenz, that is our first line therapy, is not the best drug to treat HIV, especially because of tolerance. It works, it will do the work, it will put the patient undetectable, but they need or they have a right for better care with the better drugs that we have now. I put here PrEP as a question, and of course we need to address the problem of late diagnosis. And you know what is very sad about PrEP? So we have these friendly clinics. So there's these people that is coming voluntary, so I'm MSM or transgender, and I think I am in risk. So I go there, I do the test, it's free. So you tell me, okay, congratulations, you don't have HIV. Come back in six months. So I think this population is the best one to start with PrEP. So I think we need to do it, because it's, for me it will be again a failure to actually see this patient 6 months later, having done PrEP, and then tell the patient, now you have HIV. So what can we do? I think definitely we need this sex education law. And the last 2 weeks we have been talking in different media, trying to talk about that. Treatment availability. Even if I am telling you it's for free, we have universal coverage, we have drugs, I have to be honest, there are months that we don't have some antiretrovirals. And I just read a message that, for example, I cannot start patients in raltegravir, for example, that is an integrase inhibitor, because we are about to have a stock out of this drug. And it's very, very difficult to work like that. And we need to access, better access to the test and stop zero stigma and discrimination. What we need next, we need more health promoters and navigators. We have some in the clinic, and her name is Maria, and she has done really a difference. She's trying to call the patients when they don't come to their appointment. She's always trying to help them. Now there is a WhatsApp or a cell phone that you can call to actually ask questions. This didn't happen before. But this is not supported by the Minister of Health. This comes from external agencies that I am afraid that because of this high income country that we have, we may lose all this help. And definitely we need to include more services in the clinic. I saw the 1970 clinic, and something that I learned from there is so beautiful when the patient goes there and everything is there. So it's easy for them to do everything. And one idea from there that we apply in our clinic that really made a difference is having somebody to withdraw the blood from patients. And this is what we are using for the rapid strategy, and we all love that. And the problem is when we send our patients with other specialists, there is a lot of stigma and discrimination still in our healthcare workers. And it's very sad, especially for transgender women, they are alone. For hormones, I think the endocrinologists are not, they really don't want to deal with their problems. So we really need to work there. And we know the problem with anal cancer in the future, and we are not doing anal pap smears at all still in our population, and that's another challenge that we have in the future. But not everything is bad. We have some research initiative, and I have to thank definitely UAB, because we have, right now, we have a protocol approved to actually look for the prevalence of STIs in the people living with HIV in my clinic. So I really want to see the numbers, because we haven't done before. In the future, I hope that with Amanda Willick, we finally better understand the underweight and obesity, especially with these integrase inhibitors that we know that now the problem is related with, especially with obesity. Definitely histo and crypto, with the help of the CDC, is also being addressed. Tuberculosis and this rapid initiation therapy that we also need to gather the data to see how this works. Related to educational initiative, well, we are open for clinical rotations, research pilot initiative, and especially working with Dr. Germán Nostroza from Gorga Center for Geomed, that is also being very supportive. We have many projects in the future. As a conclusion, Panama, I think I showed you, has a high prevalence, and right now has the second place for Central America as prevalence of HIV, 0.9%. As you have done a test, right, at the end of the presentation. There are unmet needs related to sex education law and access for sex healthcare adolescents. We need to go beyond a law. We need to give them access. But I have no idea how a parent in Panama will allow me to give their 16 years old or 15 years old access to family planning methods or to condoms or to even, for example, PrEP. So that will be very difficult. Testing for HIV needs to be done earlier. 60% of the new diagnoses are being done late. We need to have continued access for treatment and viral load tests, and we need better support, especially for linkage and retention of care in our HIV patients. Thank you. I need to acknowledge the help with this presentation with the chief of the National HIV Program, Lisette Chan. Definitely Amanda Gapster, that I show you from some of her works. Maria Mastellari from the Department of Epidemiology of the Minister of Health. Feliz Diaz, I didn't talk to you so much about it, but we as an infectious diseases, we are not enough people to treat people with HIV. And we have been doing educational activities, training general physicians to also treat people with HIV, and Felix Diaz is a really great, good one. We don't have the figure of the nurse practitioner. I would love to have nurse practitioners in Panama. I also would like to thank Carlos Beltran. He's the leader for the Latin American workshop for HIV. Definitely Germán Enostroza, who I met through the Gorgas Tropical Medicine course. From 2014, to 2019, I think I have been seeing a lot of changes in my professional life thanks to that course, and definitely the chief of our service, Dr. Amalia Rodriguez. Thank you.